Hello. Well, I'm having a small problem trying to share my presentation. I will try to do other solution. Give me a second. Well, hello everybody. My name is Alejandra Costa. I will just be doing the opening for this session, for this webinar. The webinar is called DHCP V6 and IPv6 Concepts. The webinar will be given by our friend Tonko Fim. I hope I am pronouncing it right.
You are Alejandro.
And thank you, Tom. And before I start, I want to thank Tonko Fim for being with us. It is a pleasure to have you inside what we call the LACNIC family. For your information, Tom Kofim, he's an expert in DHCP, V6, in IPv6 address plan, in DNS. He's working for Infoblox in this moment. He has been in at least in one LACNIC meeting before. So for us, it's an honor to have you with us. We wish we believe that we are going to learn a lot from you today. I also, before we start, I want to remind to all of you that all the webinars, all the LACNIC webinars are in the LACNIC channel in YouTube. Okay? We are starting every webinar in our LACNIC channel, so it can be reviewed later. I also want to tell you that in case you have a particular topic that you wish us, I mean LACNIC, you want it to be to have a webinar about, please feel free to contact me. Any IPv6 topic that you wish to talk about, please let me know. I do not guarantee that we're going to do it, but I promise you that we will do our best to find the right person to do it. Also, having said that, please, as I said before, the session is being recorded. So, I want you to participate, to make questions, to ask whatever you want, but please keep in mind that it is being recorded. So, take care in case you want to say or not, maybe some sensitive information about your company. And finally, Tom and Dom, please feel free to start. I will make yourself a presenter.
Thank you, Alejandro. Thanks for that kind introduction, and it's a real honor and pleasure to be here today to talk about DHCPv6 and IPv6. I'm going to pause here and make sure that my audio is good. Alejandro, can you hear me okay and everything sounds good?
Everything sounds good. I can hear you perfectly.
Okay, very good. So yeah, it's again, it's really a great opportunity here to present in front of the LACNIC audience again. I was at the meeting in Havana, Cuba, and presented on DHCPv6 there. Some of my slides are similar to that presentation. You'll recognize some if you were at that meeting. We're going to be covering DHCPv6 at a fairly high level. I'm going to try to get into some of the operational quirks that we see related to DHCPv6. We probably won't have an opportunity to do a deep dive into some of the more challenging operational deployment issues with DHCPv6, but if we have anybody on the call that's deployed it, they're probably aware of the fact that DHCPV6 has some challenges, and it's definitely a protocol that's evolving. As a subset of overall IPv6, it's probably one of the more challenging operational components of IPv6. So hopefully at the end of this presentation, you'll have a better idea of what the overall technology looks like related to DHCPV6, and you'll have a better idea of where the trouble spots may be for DHCPV6 as you deploy it. The presentation is focused on more of a sort of enterprise view of DHCPV6. I realize that service providers deploy it as well. The good thing is that the basic technology itself, the components of DHCPV6, aren't significantly different. Just with service provider, typically we see a prefix delegation deployment. If you don't know what that is, don't worry. We'll talk about that a little bit during the course of the presentation. So the first thing I'm going to do here is bring up my presentation. I've run into challenges before with WebEx trying to do a full screen presentation for PowerPoint, so we may be stuck with having to look at PowerPoint's ugly interface that's not in presentation mode, but I'm going to go ahead and attempt to put this in full screen slideshow mode, and we'll see if everybody can see what they need we'll see if everybody can see what it should look like. So, Alejandro, does that can you verify that are you seeing the presentation?
Yes, I see it. I believe that I see it perfectly.
Okay, good.
Yeah, it looks fine to me.
Okay, very good. That's good. Okay, so I have a few of my favorite IPv6 memes on this page. I'll leave it up for just a minute. As Alejandro mentioned, this is being recorded, so if you want to get a chuckle from your fellow IPv6 nerds, you know, maybe you can refer to this later on. But I suppose the one to keep in mind here, the theme for the day will be keep calm and enable IPv6, but I would add to that, try to keep calm while you're enabling DHCPV6. It will definitely challenge you to keep calm as you're doing it, as we'll see with some of the operational issues that we get into here. So my background is, I've been at Infoblox for about the last 5 years. I'm an IPv6 evangelist here at Infoblox. Infoblox is a little unique for the size of vendor that we are, somewhere around 800 people or so. We have a dedicated IPv6 practice. Of course, being a DDI vendor of DNS, DHCP, and IP address management solutions, IPv6 is obviously a big part of that, so it does make sense that we would have a focus on IPv6. Part of the reason that I came on board at Infoblox 5 years ago was I was using Infoblox IP address management as a solution at Limelight Networks, where I deployed IPv6 on their global IP backbone. And I liked the solution so much, and I liked the idea of the opportunity of talking to folks and encouraging them to adopt IPv6, that I was very happy and lucky to be able to come on board at Infoblox as an IPv6 evangelist. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about the DDI solution and the feature set that we offer here at Infoblox. I have one slide that just will go over very briefly, just the sort of IPv6 feature and functional parity that we offer in our DDI solution. But I certainly encourage you to investigate what we have to offer if DDI is a solution that makes sense for your organization, and of course it does for most organizations. So we'll start off with IPv6 statistics. This is information that may or may not be familiar to you. I've kept it focused on the Latin American region so that we can get an idea of who the big IPv6 adopters are, which countries in Latin America are the big IPv6 adopters at this point. Chances are you already know this information. We'll talk a little bit about why certain countries are doing a little better than others in terms of IPv6 adoption levels. Something that the audience is probably is already keenly aware of. Right now, if we look at the overall international levels of IPv6 traffic, so globally, if we take a look at the traffic that's hitting Google over IPv6, we see that it's around 14%, and you can see that curve up and to the right, something approximating an exponential growth in IPv6, and we're going to take a look at what the estimates are for when IPv6 becomes the dominant protocol on the internet here in a second. But first, let's look at, in Latin America in particular, some of the network operator stats that we see for, in this instance, the national telecommunications infrastructure in Ecuador. We see that they're at about 31% of their overall traffic is over IPv6. In Brazil, the provider Copel, among others, but that particular provider is at 21%. Peru Telefonica, 14% or so of their traffic is over IPv6. And again, in Brazil, the provider Vivo is around 8%. So these are examples of providers, whether they're larger or smaller ISPs that are actually supporting IPv6 on their core backbones. And so as a result, we see the levels of IPv6 adoption in terms of users in those countries increasing. So in Brazil right now, the number of IPv6 users, the percentage of IPv6 users, and I think this is somewhere around 10% in Brazil, and we see that that's jumped up from around the middle of 2015, or rather towards the beginning of 2015 when we started to see an increase in the overall level of IPv6 traffic. And we see the same thing, of course, in Peru, which is up around 16%. And they got started on their IPv6 deployment a little earlier, back in 2013. But again, we see the levels increasing, and now we're around 16% in Peru. And Ecuador currently has, as far as I know, at last check, it has the highest level of IPv6 traffic, highest percentage of IPv6 users at around 19 or 20%. And again, that's very recent, since the end of 2014, the beginning of 2015. So you see with the combination of ISPs and service providers adopting IPv6 in these regions, providing IPv6 to end users, whether they're mobile devices or fixed broadband devices, we see the overall level of IPv6 being driven up. So then that leads us to the question of when IPv6 will become the dominant protocol on the internet. Right now, Cisco is predicting that will happen sometime around 2018. We've actually seen not only Cisco, but some other data scientists, some other folks that have analyzed this question of when we'll see IPv6 adoption peak, exceed 50%, and at that point, IPv4 becomes the legacy protocol on the internet. So sometime around 2018 is the prediction. What that means for both service providers and enterprises is pretty clear. I think, as we've seen with the countries in Latin America that are adopting today, countries like Brazil, Ecuador, and Peru, there's a recognition that the economics of continuing to support IPv4 aren't all that sustainable when we start to look 5 and 10 years out, even a couple of years down the road where IPv6 becomes the dominant protocol on the internet. We're likely to see tremendous cost pressures in terms of the vendors that are supporting both IPv4 and IPv6 today, whether they're service provider or hardware and software vendors, are going to be looking for excuses to remove IPv4 from their code trains once IPv6 is the dominant protocol on the internet. If they're not able to do that, then they're very likely to desire to charge more for IPv4 in the short term and the medium term, and certainly service providers. We've already seen some of this in service providers where we're seeing additional costs associated with having, say, for a business ISP service, you actually have to pay a premium to continue to support IPv4 in certain markets. So we've already started to see that happen. So we're likely to see more of that as IPv6 becomes the dominant protocol. So then the segue to DHCPv6 should be pretty obvious. I mean, if we're going to be needing to support IPv6 in our networks going forward, then the next question is, how are we going to provision IPv6 addresses? We've got a number of methods that work today. DHCP v4 has a long established practice in both the enterprise and the service provider space. And DHCP v6 It should be as simple as, and I think in a lot of people's minds, the idea is that DHCPV6 is exactly like DHCPV4. It's just something that they'll have to turn on. They'll enable it, and then it will begin to allow them to provision IPv6 addresses, and it won't be any more complicated than that. The truth is that it's actually a bit more complicated. There's a lot of moving parts related to the fact that DHCPV6 is really been built from scratch, and it's taken certain concepts from DHCPV4, certain protocol components from DHCPV4. But there's more that, there's probably more that's different than is the same with DHCPV6. So the first question is then, before we get into the details of what the protocol looks like under the hood, as we say, what are the contexts in which we're likely to see DHCPV6 used? And it's not probably surprising to the listeners on the call that we're likely to see DHCPV6 wherever we have DHCPV4 currently deployed. So corporate LAN environments are probably the biggest, will end up being the biggest deployers of DHCPV6 in the long run, mainly because they currently use DHCPV4 for IPv4 address provisioning. Going forward, we're likely to see much greater adoption of DHCPV6 in corporate LAN environments. Right now, the typical enterprise is lagging behind in deploying IPv6. And actually, when I say lagging behind in deploying IPv6, really they're lagging behind in intentionally deploying IPv6, because the truth is that all of their operating systems that are running on the network, all the mobile devices and laptops and desktops, they're all currently supporting IPv6 already, and it's already enabled by default and preferred by default if there's an actual valid IPv6 address that's able to be provisioned. So corporate LAN environments, the actual intentional deployment of DHCPv6, we're likely to see that that's necessary. And that's based on the fact that we needed additional administrative control in a corporate LAN environment. And I need to back up here and say that we've got some alternatives, and I have a slide later on that will show us the auto-addressing choices that we have when we're dealing with IPv6. One of the ways in which IPv6 is different than IPv4 in terms of its design was that from the very beginning, IPv6 was designed in order to support auto-addressing, something that was added after the fact to IPv4. If you go back to the early days of the internet and the early days of business networks, it was pretty much standard operating procedure that if you wanted to put a device on the network, you were going to statically provision an address if you were running IP. We see some of the older legacy protocols like AppleTalk having some early iterations of auto-addressing that were actually pretty clever and pretty well designed for the time. But IP was the one that actually had to have DHCP sort of added after the fact in order to support auto-provisioning of IP addresses. So with IPv6, the idea was that we would improve upon IP by adding an auto-addressing function. And the built-in auto-addressing function of IPv6 is stateless address auto-configuration, or SLAC. The great thing about SLAC is that it's a very easy protocol to deploy, a very easy component of IPv6 to deploy, and it's an easy way to get nodes up and running on an IPv6 network without a lot of additional configuration information. The bad news related to SLAC is that it doesn't really allow you to tightly control the deployment of those IPv6 addresses in any way that doesn't require you to add a lot of additional sort of coding overlay to manage and track those IPv6 addresses that you're deploying through SLAC. It doesn't mean you can't do it. It just means that, you'll really be required to take more of a DevOps approach. And for certain service providers, they've decided that, maybe that's the way that they want to go in the short term. But again, you need to be able to, in a service provider environment, you need to be able to do prefix delegation in order to assign more than one address to a client. And so in that case, you're going to need DHCPV6. So wherever DHCPV4 is deployed today, DHCPV6 is likely going to be the choice going forward, with the caveat of the size of the network. Again, I may have DHCPV4 running in a lab environment where I just want to stand something up and get addresses configured very quickly. SLAC may be something that I'd like to use in order just to get addresses on nodes and get those nodes connected. If I need that tighter administrative control, then I'm definitely going to need to use DHCPv6. Because of the way enterprise networks are run and because of DHCPv4 being mature to the tune of having 20 years worth of deployment experience related to DHCPv4, there's a lot of additional administrative tools that we have in our belt in order to be able to effectively manage IP addresses that are assigned via DHCPv4. So do we have those same tools available in DHCPv6? Yes and no. So we'll look at that a little bit more in the presentation, a little bit later in the presentation as we dig into some of the operational issues that we run into. So wherever we need prefix delegation, again, if I need to assign, and this is the great thing about IPv6, DHCPv6, is that I have a mechanism that allows me to automatically assign a prefix, an IPv6 prefix, larger than just a single address. We still are dealing with the limitation in IPv6 or the protocol rule that specifies we have 64 bits that are reserved for the network and 64 bits that are reserved for the interface ID. So I can't assign, I shouldn't be assigning a prefix that's any smaller than a /64. And you'll find that most ISPs are assigning for the prefixes that they're delegating to their fixed broadband devices, their home DSL gateways or cable modems. In most cases, it's at least a /60 or 16/64s. In some cases, it's a /56. It seems to be that there's a standard sort of evolving or emerging around a /56 as the standard prefix that's being delegated for a home user, which is, of course, 256/64 subnets. And the idea here is that even though a home user may only have a handful of devices today, the home network in the future is likely to have many more devices connected. So we'll see a slide on that later on in the presentation. So stateless DHCPv6 might be used where clients don't support stateful DHCPv6. There are some that don't today, and we'll take a look at some of the conditions around that a little later in the presentation. So a brief DHCPv6 review. So this will be a really high-level sort of view of some of the components in DHCPv6 and what we need to know in order to be able to manage DHCPv6 effectively. So we can compare DHCPv4 with DHCPv6. The basic characteristics, the difference between the two protocols, the address type used for server discovery and solicitation, that's broadcast in IPv4. DHCPv4 uses a broadcast mechanism. So, and this is basically happening at layer 2. And there are both benefits and challenges to this. Obviously, scoping the size of the broadcast domain is always a consideration. Having to have, IP helper addresses on routers in order to have an IPv4 DHCP server that's sitting off of the network on a different network and those layer 2 packets having to be forwarded to that DHCPv4 server. So that's kind of a limitation that's built into the way that DHCP was added to IPv4. It's definitely kind of stuck at layer 2 with broadcast. With DHCPv6, we've actually got multicast. We're leveraging multicast, and we're leveraging the fact that before I do anything with an IPv6 node, I actually have to make sure that that node has a link local address. So the IPv6 node is going to configure itself with a link local address before it does anything, which means that any of the requests that are coming from that node to do DHCPv6, those requests can be sent over layer 3. They can be sent using that built-in link local address in IPv6 to allow them to connect to the DHCPv6 server. And this allows a little more tight control. It allows the network architecture to be cleaner. Of course, it adds a little complexity to the mix, but we'll look at a slide here in a minute that shows that transaction. The default gateway, this is the biggest difference, and if you don't know anything about DHCPv6, if you're tuning in today and if you forget everything else about this presentation, keep this in mind. You don't get a default gateway from the server in IPv6 like you do in IPv4. So, normally the DHCP server will provide a default gateway. In IPv6, in DHCPv6, that's provided by the router advertisement. So I absolutely have to have a router configured with IPv6 on that same segment. That router interface configuration has to be, sending router advertisements that are letting the individual IPv6 nodes on that link know that there is an IPv6 subnet configured, and they're going to be using that IPv6 subnet in order to determine what the gateway is to get off of that link and to get to the rest of the network and/or the internet. So the DHCPv6 transaction acronym is a little different. We know it as DORA and IPv4. So we see the discovery packet, the offer packet, the request packet, and the acknowledgement packet. That's basically the handshake that happens between the node and the IPv4 DHCP server. In IPv6 and DHCPv6, it's a solicit, advertise, request, and reply instead of the discover, offer, request, and acknowledgement. And we can shorten that. There's actually a fast provisioning mechanism in DHCPv6 that basically allows you to shorten that to just two of those, which is basically solicit and reply. The host identifier, this is another big difference between IPv4 and IPv6. In IPv4, it's the MAC address, and of course, we have a tremendous amount of provisioning technology sort of built around having this MAC address available to us, being able to look at the MAC address of the requesting node in order to do, say, a fixed address assignment, or in order to track that, that node going forward. Well, the challenge with the MAC address relating to a node is that the MAC address concept presumes that you only have basically one address per node. And of course, with IPv6, IPv6 was built to allow you to have multiple IPv6 addresses that are scoped differently that allow you to connect to different resources. I can have a unique local address. I can have a global unicast address. I can have a link local address. I can have a temporary or a private address, and all these addresses are configured on a single node in order for that node to communicate to different resources. So I need something other than just a MAC address in order to track that node. And so that's where the DHCP unique identifier comes in, which is an acronym of an acronym, which is a little crazy, but that's where we're at. So the DUID allows you then to track a node based on an abstract value that isn't tied to the interface. So then the question is, well, how do I track an address on an interface? What primitive or abstract do I use in order to track an address that's configured on an interface? So that's where the interface, the identity association for the DUID comes in, and we'll look at that in a moment. Source address port, we use the broadcast address in DHCPv4 in v6 because we've already got an IP address configured. We can go ahead and use that link local address in order to initiate those requests and communicate with the DHCPv6 server. It uses a different port over UDP as well. And as you can see, destination address and port, again, the broadcast address. And in this case, we're using a multicast IPv6 address in order to communicate with the DHCPv6 servers. And that's a well-known reserved locally scoped address with the 02:1:2. That's actually the all DHCPv6 servers reserved multicast address for communicating with the DHCPv6 server. So the DHCP unique identifier, or DUID, it's used by DHCPv6 instead of the MAC address to identify clients and servers. So you have to have a DUID configured on the server as well. The client has to have at least one DUID configured. This is supposed to be, it's supposed to persist over time. So it's supposed to persist across reboot. So if I have a DUID assigned, like say in the case of Windows, it's actually an entry in the registry. It's not supposed to change. Of course, this can be interesting if I need a unique DUID per client, and let's say I'm cloning a bunch of Windows servers or Windows clients. If I clone them, then they're all going to end up with the same DUID. So this is something that I actually have to maybe go in and manually change in order to make sure I've got a unique DUID per client. It's set at boot time and persists across reboots. And it's basically there to identify the node, either the client or the server. So the identity association is a different abstract that's used to identify, group, and manage sets of related assigned IPv6 addresses. So client interfaces have multiple IPv6 addresses, as I mentioned, but they have one identity association assigned per interface, and that identity association can be for temporary, non-temporary, or prefixes, depending on which address grouping that you're, which address function that you're assigning. So the non-temporary address is an address that shouldn't change over time or should change very infrequently. So I'll have one identity association for that. I'll have a different identity association for temporary address, and then I'll have one for prefix delegation, which I don't have listed here. So the question, if I'm running an enterprise network and I want to find out what the identity association is for a node, there's good news and bad news. The good news is that Windows, if I do an ipconfig all, it will show me the identity association for a particular interface. I don't know of a way, and I've checked on this on a fairly regular basis, I don't know of a way to see that identity association using a Mac. I don't know of an easy way to do it using Linux. It seems like there should be a way. But again, if I'm trying to use that value to manage that node and the interfaces, the addresses on the interface on that node, DHCPv6 is actually not matured to the point where I can actually easily look at that information and use that as a basis for perhaps provisioning or tracking addresses. So one of the limitations that that we still haven't reached a mature point with related to DHCPv6. So I've got some choices related to DHCPv6, how I'm going to run it. I can run it statefully or I can run it statelessly. So the IPv6 address assignment, stateful DHCPv6, I get that address from a DHCPv6 server. With stateless, I get it through SLAC or stateless auto address configuration. So in other words, with stateless, I'm going to go ahead and configure an address exactly the same way I would with SLAC. The router advertisement is going to offer me a prefix, and that node is actually going to assign its interface identifier based on that prefix. The additional DHCP options with stateful DHCPv6, I get them from the server, and the same is true with stateless DHCPv6. So this is a scenario where I want to get the address using SLAC, but I want to get my DNS servers, my domain search list, all that stuff, TFTP server if I need it, I'm going to get that from the DHCPv6 server. But again, very important to remember, regardless of which of these two I use, the default gateway is provided by the router advertisement from the router. So I don't get that from the server in either case. It's important to keep that in mind. So let's take a look at DHCPv6 transaction. Basically, I start off with a host. This is just a node that's on a generic LAN segment that I have DHCPv6 configured on. IPv6 host A, it has a valid link local address derived from its MAC address. Now, I haven't shown what this process looks like. So in other words, before we even get to step one for DHCPv6, this node has already configured itself with a link local address. Using the link local address auto configuration, it tests that address to make sure that it's unique using duplicate address detection. Once it's validated that, then it's got a unique layer 3 address that can only be used on that segment. So that link local address is only locally, it's only link local in scope, meaning that any traffic, any packets that are sourced from that address have a TTL of 255 and cannot get off that link. So they can only communicate with other devices on that link. So the DHCPv6 transaction then, starting with that node already having a link local address, it's going to send a solicit to the link local scope all DHCP servers multicast address, which we saw earlier. That's that FF02:1:2 address. So the source address is the link local address that we saw that the node has already configured itself with. And it's sending that that DHCPv6 solicit to the all link local scope all DHCP servers multicast address. So then the DHCPv6 server responds with a unicast DHCPv6 advertisement. So this is different than what we had in V4, where the server is going to respond in a broadcast fashion. Here it's got a layer 3 address that it can use by default, so it's going to go ahead and send that advertisement back to the link local address of the soliciting client. And so you can see here the packet has a source. The source address is the link local of the server interface, and the destination is that link local address of the node that requested that sent out that solicitation and requested the address in the first place. So host A unicasts a DHCPv6 request to the server. Now that it has the link local address from the response that it received, it can go ahead and send that request. And then the DHCPv6 server responds with a unicast DHCPv6 reply that contains the IPv6 address and any additional network configuration options. So the source, again, the link local being sent to the destination link local address of the node. And then I've got now the ability to configure my global unicast address using the address that was provided by the DHCPv6 server, along with any DNS servers, domain search lists, any of those other DHCP options that I want to learn from the server. So that's the basic transaction. And again, just keep in mind that it's happening over layer 3 with that link local address that's already configured. And even though I'm getting a unicast address from the DHCPv6 server along with my DNS servers and domain search lists, any of that other information, I'm still getting the default gateway from the router on the link, which isn't shown in this transaction. So the other DHCP transaction that we're likely to encounter, and this is more on the service provider side, is prefix delegation. So the concept is the same. I've got a DHCP server. In this case, I've got a cable modem router that's connected to a home network, and I want to be able to assign a DHCPv6 prefix or an IPv6 prefix to that cable modem or router that the home user that can then assign addresses from. So as I mentioned, the standard is sort of congealing around a /56 as the prefix of choice to use for a cable modem or a router. Actually, in this case, I think I'm giving a /56 to the CMTS, the cable management, the access layer device. This is the equivalent of a DSLAM and a DSL environment. I'm giving the access layer a /56, and the cable modem or router is only going to get a /64 in this case. And I say only, of course, that's relative. A /64 is still, 1.8 times 10 to the 19th addresses, obviously more than the home user will ever consume. But because I've only got that single /64, technically I'm not supposed to do any other subnetting, which means that home network then could only have that one /64 network. There couldn't be any additional layer 3 subnetting or logical subnetting done to carve up that assignment. So in this case, that /64 then is going to be used to configure the home user's global unicast address. But a more interesting example is where I've got a larger home network, and this is what we're likely to see in the future, where home networks consist of smart grid technology that the utilities are using to manage the utilities for the home. You might have security systems that have their own segmented networks. Home entertainment systems, set-top boxes that are connected to a separate network that the cable provider is providing. Of course, data networks that you're using for home use, et cetera. Whatever you imagine the future home to look like in terms of its networking needs, I'm probably going to need more than a /64 in order to be able to do that. And if you want more information on sort of the thinking behind what those home networks are going to look like and how that's going to be provisioned, the IETF has a HomeNet working group that focuses on future networks and how to handle routing and prefix assignment of IPv6 within the home network. So in this case, I'm going to need a larger allocation. If I want to go ahead and assign a /56 to the cable modem or router, I might be getting a /48 that's assigned down to the CMTS, and then in this case, I've gone ahead and assigned a /60 because of that /48 allocation. I'll have around 4,096 /60s that I can hand out. And in this case, the cable modem gets the /60, and then my home network I can use different /64 networks to assign to different network functions within the home. So managing DHCPv6, it's a little different than what you're probably used to in DHCPv4. Because I've basically divided the functionality of DHCPv6 between the DHCPv6 server and the router on the segment, I actually have to have configuration elements configured on both locations in order to support the flavor of DHCPv6 that I want to run depending on my operational requirements. So if we go back to the question of stateful versus stateless DHCPv6 or SLAC, stateless address auto configuration, I've got basically three auto address configuration methods that I can use. And these are not, it's important to keep in mind that these are not mutually exclusive. So I can have, I can be running SLAC, stateless, and stateful DHCPv6 on the same segment, and a node can go ahead and configure itself with multiple auto address configuration method types depending on how I have the flag settings set. So in this case, this example, I'm starting from the assumption that you would only configure one auto address configuration method at a time. And most deployments, that's what we want. We don't want to have multiple auto address configuration methods running. We want one or the other of the types that we have at our disposal. So if I want to run SLAC, if I want to run any of these auto address configuration methods, I have to set the appropriate configuration flags in the router advertisement. So that configuration is actually done on the router and not on the DHCPv6 server. So the ICMPv6 router advertisement that's coming from the router that's on the segment, if I want to go ahead and configure a stateless address auto configuration, I set the A flag and I leave the M flag and O flag unset. So if I look at, and I don't have the example here to show the audience today, but it's pretty easy to find. If you, like, for instance, on a Cisco router, you know, on the interface, the interface configuration or the sub-interface configuration where I'm entering the logical elements related to the interface configuration, I've got some IPv6 configuration elements that allow me to set these different flags. The wording isn't just A flag, M flag, and O flag, so you have to do a little bit of digging. I'll have to add that as a slide going forward. In any case, if I go ahead and have that A flag set with the M flag and the O flag unset, and A stands for auto address configuration, M stands for managed, and O stands for other. And basically that means A, you can think of A as the SLAC flag. If I have A set, then I'm expecting to use SLAC to get the IPv6 address. The M flag is basically the DHCPv6 stateful flag. If I have the M flag set, then I want to go ahead and use the DHCPv6 server to get my IPv6 address. And the O flag is the other flag indicating that I'm going to get my additional information, like my DNS server or domain search list, from the DHCPv6 server. So you can see if I have that A flag set and the other two flags unset, the resulting IPv6 addresses that are configured, well, naturally I'm going to have a link local address, but I'm also going to have an IPv6 global unicast address, assuming that that's the prefix that I have defined on the router, that it's global in scope, and then potentially a temporary address as well. If I need for some reason to be able to run SLAC, because I have a client that doesn't support DHCPv6, and this is the case with Android, as we'll see just a little bit in the presentation, Android doesn't support DHCPv6. So I have to use SLAC in order to address to give the Android device an IPv6 address. But I still need DNS information, obviously, and domain search information, but at least the DNS server. I'm going to be getting that in this case not from a DHCPv6 server, but from RFC 6106 or RDNSS support, and we're seeing clients with better support for that. Obviously, Android must support it since it doesn't support DHCPv6, but we're seeing that support in other devices as well. So in the case where I want to run stateless DHCPv6, again, I'm getting my address through SLAC, I've got the A flag set, I've got the M flag unset, and I've got the O flag set. So in this case, I get the same link local IPv6 and temporary IPv6 address, potentially, and the DHCPv6 server provides me additional configuration options. And then finally, stateful DHCPv6, I go ahead and unset that A flag, meaning I'm not going to get the address through SLAC. I have the M flag set. The O flag is typically set here, although according to the standards, it's not supposed to be read or considered, but in most cases, you'll see the M flag and the O flag set together in stateful DHCPv6. So in that case, I have my link local address that the node auto configures, but then I also have a DHCPv6 address. And of course, I'm going to get my DNS servers from my DNS server information from the DHCPv6 server. But having said all that, we still see some strange behavior in how auto-addressing behaves. If I go ahead and I set the flags according to this slide, then I should be able to rely on getting consistent behavior that gives me an address based on whether or not I want to use Slack, stateful, or stateless DHCPv6. In reality, though, we see some strange behavior. So in the case where a host has not acquired any addresses, and there's no router advertisement, we still have some popular OSs acquiring a DHCPv6 address. So this is a scenario where I have a LAN segment where I don't have a router advertisement going out on the link at all. So when a node gets a router advertisement, it's not getting a router advertisement at all, it shouldn't assume that there's a DHCPv6 server that it should be using or attempting to use to get an address. But in the case of Windows, it actually goes ahead and sends out an IPv6, a DHCPv6 solicit just to try to get an address in the hopes that there's a DHCPv6 configured on the link. So, according to the protocol standards, this is probably broken behavior, or it is broken behavior. But from the standpoint of running an IPv6 network in an enterprise environment, this is actually probably something I would want. I would, if I'm connecting a node to a link and I want to get on the network, I want it to attempt to get an IPv6 address using DHCPv6. But again, it's something you need to be aware of because it's potentially a security risk. And again, I haven't stated this yet, but it's important to keep in mind that we're seeing a lot of variance in terms of how these DHCPv6 clients are behaving, and this changes from update to update. So you may see Windows or Mac OS X or Android or iOS, you may see them behaving a particular way in relation to DHCPv6. In one release, and then with the new release, a new update, you may see that behavior change. And so if you're running an enterprise network environment, you have to do a lot of testing, and you can't assume that DHCPv6 is just going to operate the same way that it's operated previously on clients. So another example of this, a host has not acquired any addresses. The M flag is set to 0, the O flag is set to 1, but the auto addressing flag is not set. Some popular OSs will acquire other info from DHCPv6 addresses. Others do so only if the Slack flag is set to 1. So this is assuming that you're actually getting. This is assuming that you've set the A flag to 1 in order to get an address via Slack, but you're actually going to go ahead and get that additional DHCPv6 address information if that A flag is set to 1. This may or may not be what you want, depending on the deployment that you have. Here's an example where the host has acquired an address from DHCPv6 only. I've got an RA with an M flag set to 0. So some OSs release DHCPv6 immediately, and some release only on the expiration of the address. And that's something that we haven't really talked about in this presentation is the valid and preferred lifetime concept. That's how it's leveraged in IPv6. We have the same thing in V4. It's handled a little more with a little more rigor in IPv6 and DHCPv6. So it's something you may want to do a little bit of research on if you're planning on deploying IPv6, DHCPv6. So the host, in the case where the host has acquired an address from Slack only, the router advertisement has the M flag set to 1, which should indicate that DHCPv6 is supposed to be used. In some OSs, we see the release of DHCPv6 immediately, and some release only if Slack addresses have expired and can't be refreshed. So the information that's on this slide, this is from probably 12 months ago. I don't know if host OSs are still behaving this way, but the point is still the same. The point is that if you're operating DHCPv6 in an enterprise network, you have to test your clients with every release to make sure that they're behaving the same way, depending on which auto-addressing mechanism you're using. So here's one that's related specifically to Windows 7, 8, and 10. I've already mentioned it. This is the case where the A, M, and O flags are all set to 0, or there's no router advertisement at all, but I have a DHCPv6 server configured on the link. In OS X, I don't get an address because I wouldn't expect to get any address with none of the flags configured and no router advertisement. With Windows 7, 8, or 10, if I've got a DHCPv6 server on the link, it will go ahead and configure a DHCPv6 address. So in this case, Windows is ignoring the auto-addressing flags that are set in the router advertisement. And then we just saw this recently with the Windows 10 anniversary update. No IPv6 address via DHCPv6 after the laptop or mobile device, the laptop, I think, in this case, or desktop, comes out of sleep or hibernate mode. The DHCPv6 address goes away and isn't refreshed properly. So that's just something that happened within the last month. Just something to keep in mind. You got to keep a close eye on DHCPv6 in your operational environment. So as I mentioned, there's no DHCPv6 for Android unless you're on an external application, or an application rather on the Android device. You can do that. Of course, that doesn't really scale because you have to root the device. And if I'm running an enterprise network, I don't need to be running around rooting the devices of the folks that are connecting to the network. So it's really not manageable for enterprise deployments. So then the question is, will we ever see DHCPv6 for Android? Right now, it's not looking like we will anytime soon. In the meantime, we're seeing RDNSS support, RFC 6106 support for other devices, for other OSs rather. So Windows and Mac OS X, we're seeing a push to support RDNSS so that in those enterprise environments, I can run Slack and stateless DHCPv6 and still effectively manage the auto addressing. But right now, if I'm running auto addressing in an enterprise environment in IPv6, I basically have to run DHCPv6, stateful DHCPv6 next to stateless DHCPv6 or Slack with RDNSS support in order to support all the devices, because we don't have DHCPv6 support in Android. So here's a couple of more complex DHCPv6 operational issues. The first one is DHCPv6 failover. It's often repeated that it's not needed unless you're doing prefix delegation. There's no proprietary implementation of it yet. So Infoblox, for instance, has DHCPv4 failover, which it implemented a proprietary version of back in the day. We don't yet have a DHCPv6 failover version. For enterprises, I understand that this is frustrating. They want to be able to just check a box and have DHCPv6 failover. Because of the additional state that's required in DHCPv6 and the relative complexity of the transaction, we don't have, I think we're just to the point now where we're on the verge of having an RFC for DHCPv6 failover that defines all the requirements for it. So we may see an enterprise, a proprietary implementation of it soon. The existing RFCs that we have show redundancy deployment considerations, and we'll take a look at one of those in a second that actually shows you a workaround for not having DHCPv6 failover. So hopefully we'll have an actual RFC soon, and hopefully we'll have a standard implementation of DHCPv6 failover that allows you to statefully track both DHCPv6 and DHCPv4 in the case where one of your servers goes away. Right now, what you have to do, one of the probably the most simple option for having a workaround for DHCPv6 failover is just doing split prefixes. So in this case, I've got a couple of DHCPv6 servers. I configure them with their own subnets. In this case, I've got a single /64, but I go ahead and break the rule of not subnetting the /64. Of course, this is just a DHCPv6 range, so it's not actually technically a subnet. I set one of the preferences, the server preference value, to 255, so that one server is preferred unless it goes away. Then the other server becomes preferred, and then we can basically see, I can do this with any number of servers, and then over time, what happens is that I get an uneven distribution of leases, which, if I have to reconcile having, once that new server, that old server that went offline for whatever reason, once I have to bring it back online, and I have to reconcile those leases, that can be problematic, much more complicated than I'd like it to be. Failover would fix this problem. Built-in automatic failover would fix this problem. So again, hopefully it's something that we'll see deployed soon. So the next thing we'll look at briefly is what first hop security looks like in relation to DHCPv6. So this is something that's already supported on Cisco, and it's a scenario where because I can basically, if I'm a bad actor, if I'm a black hat or a hacker, and I have access to the local LAN segment, I can pretend like I'm a DHCPv6 server in the same way that I might pretend like I'm a, I can pretend like I'm the gateway by using router advertisements in IPv6 in order to basically launch a man-in-the-middle attack and redirect traffic to myself in order to basically see all of the traffic that's being transacted on the link. So what that looks like in DHCPv6 is when that solicit goes out, if I'm a hacker and I've got a rogue DHCPv6 server on the segment, I can go ahead and respond with my own advertisement. If for whatever reason the advertisement from the actual DHCPv6 server doesn't have the server preference set right, the default is 0, potentially I could have 255 set as must prefer, and then all of a sudden I've got a man-in-the-middle attack that I have to contend with. If I have a switch, a Cisco switch with IPv6 first hop security enabled, in this case DHCPv6 guard, the same scenario happens, but this time around, the switch blocks the attempt at having basically offering myself my, you know, if I'm a rogue DHCPv6 server offering the reply over that switch port, it's going to be blocked with that DHCPv6 guard enabled. Address planning for DHCPv6. Rules of address planning don't generally change regardless of which auto-addressing method you're using. That shouldn't be any surprise. So, you know, again, think in terms of a /48 per site and a /64 per VLAN. How you carve that up within your own deployment is pretty much up to you. It just depends on the topological complexity, whether I'm doing, you know, routing summarization or I need ACLs at a certain level within the hierarchy. So then finally, where DHCPv6 is headed, here are three these are the current activities in IETF. We're seeing a complete rewriting of the DHCPv6 RFC 3315. So that's something that's happening right now. We've also got secure DHCPv6. Again, until we solve the key distribution challenge with, you know, just the general key distribution challenge and the PKI problem, it's not something that we're likely to see us deployed anytime soon. We don't see any sort of client support for it, but it's something that you may want to keep your eyes on. And then prefix length hint, so basically a way of sanely defining and managing when we get a prefix length suggested from a client to the server, how we're going to handle that. So those are three areas of development for DHCPv6. And then here's the infoblock slide that I mentioned. You know, we try to shoot for general IPv4, IPv6 feature parity with both DNS, DHCPv6, and IP address management. I won't linger on the slide. This isn't a marketing presentation. So something you can research if you're interested in a DDI solution that supports IPv6. And the Infoblox website, Infoblox, as I mentioned, has a dedicated IPv6 practice, and we you know, try to keep a bead on all of the changes that are happening within the protocol and how people are using them operationally. We have a huge footprint of enterprise deployments, a much smaller deployment of DHCPv6 because it's just not that widely deployed yet, and then, of course, on the service provider side as well. We have blogs that we update on a regular basis. Myself and my technical advisory board members, Ed Horley and Scott Hoag, who are a couple of other IPv6 experts. And we try to do solutions, white papers, webinars, that sort of thing. IPv6 deployment or IPv6 deployment. And then I have address your enterprise or service provider deployment that may be of interest to you. And that's basically all the content that I had today. I'm not sure how we're going to handle questions. We've got some time to do that. So maybe I'll turn it back over to Alejandro at this point, and we can maybe get some Q&A going if that's.
Hi, Tom. Alejandro here. Thank you so much for your presentation. It was terrific. I fully understood it, so it was very, very, very nice. Well, I want to ask to the attendees if you have any question, please. Well, Tom, Jose Peña, and I know, and I believe that the other many people will do the same. They are asking for the presentation, so in case you can send it to me, and maybe I can put it somewhere, or at least send the presentation to the people who explicitly asked for it to me. Okay. Well, I do have a question, and I hope that more people, it will encourage more people to also make questions. My question is the following, and this is something that in LACNIC we have seen in many ISPs in the region. Some people, or some ISPs, they complain about the integration of a DHCP V6 solution with their current provisioning system. Do you have some experience about this? Hola, hola, hola. Hello. Actually, I cannot hear anything too. Hello, hello. However, I can see that it looks like my computer is receiving the audio, but unfortunately, I don't see if any of you can hear me.
I can hear you.
Ah, okay, perfect. Tom, well, I pasted my question in the box, in the chat box. My question is basically if you have any experience in about integrating the DHCP V6 servers or maybe your solution to current provisioning systems that many ISPs have in this moment. Okay, let's wait just 1 minute to see if maybe Tom is back. Well, unfortunately, I actually don't know if Tom is going to come back. I don't want to have you waiting more time for him. I think that we can declare this webinar finished. We were lucky that Tom was able to finish the full webinar. Tom, in case you can hear me, really, really thank you. I really appreciate your time with us. It was very valuable for the community in Latin America. We have seen many ISPs that somehow they have the DHCPv6 implementation as an excuse for not implementing v6. So what we want with this is to close the breach and to make the ISPs to have less excuses so they can implement v6 in their network. That is at the end what we want from this. So Tom, thank you so much, and also for the attendees that last all the event, thank you so much for being with us. LACNIC has many other events and webinars in the future. Please take a look to our website. And that's all, everybody. Thank you so much one more time for being in the webinar. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much, Alejandro.
To you.
Okay, bye all.